بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Distinguished guests and ladies and gentlemen, I'm absolutely delighted to be with you this afternoon at the U.S. Chamber of Commerce, to which this is my first visit. The U.S. Chamber is the world's largest business organization. I'm also particularly delighted that we were able to get this beautiful room in which to hold this meeting. And the U.S. Chamber created a century ago to promote national economic welfare remains a symbol of the American enterprise and the dynamism of Sanjay. I would also like to avail this opportunity to thank the United States Pakistan Business Council for being a close and trusted partner in promoting business collaboration between the US and Pakistan, and also thanks is due to USPBC for providing a national forum for dialogue on key economic, political, and other issues of interest to American companies operating in or exploring business opportunities in Pakistan. And this occasion will also give me an opportunity to congratulate the new president, well, not so new, but still the Laibagar government, the new president of the United States Pakistan Business Council, Ms. Esperanza Jalalian, for her active role in promoting trade, economic, and business relations between Pakistan and the United States. It was probably this very room that the Prime Minister of Pakistan, Mr. Nawaz Sharif, was there in October 2013. And he concluded a very successful visit to Washington, during which he met President Obama, and the two leaders emphasized the need for both Pakistan and the US to work together on a range of options to enable Pakistan to achieve positive economic growth and new investment. Prime Minister Sharif highlighted his keen interest in expanding bilateral trade and investment in the US, which is Pakistan's largest trading partner and a major source of foreign direct investment. Both leaders reaffirmed their commitment, and one consequence of that commitment made in Washington last October is the Trade and Investment Framework Agreement Council, the DIPA Council meeting that happened yesterday, about which I have a few words to say. This was part of the joint declaration made by the Prime Minister, President Obama, and U.S. Trade Representative Ambassador Froman would invite his counterpart, that is myself, to the next DIPA Council in Washington. And I'm delighted that we were able to fulfill the commitment that the two leaders made. And this also demonstrates the seriousness of this commitment between Pakistan and the US, despite having a rocky relationship historically, and more rockier than most of the last 10 years. There is now a new focus and seriousness in bringing trade and investment to the forefront in this relationship. And the government of Pakistan, which was elected a year ago under the leadership of Prime Minister Nawaz Sharif, is committed to steering Pakistan away from its economic turmoil and putting Pakistan on a path of predictable economic growth through trade liberalization and liberalization and deregulation of the economy and the recent privatization program that we have initiated. As most of the participants and people in this room are aware, Pakistan has continues to have very serious problems relating to our economy and security, where energy shortage alone causes loss of about 2% of our GDP annually. In order to make up the losses over the last decade, the promotion of bilateral business, trade and investment in Pakistan is a key component and priority for the new government. We are now fully engaged in our effort on economic recovery, improved security, and good governance to attract local foreign investment. And these efforts, I'm delighted to report, have started to show positive results. Foreign direct investment, which had fallen consistently in the last decade has started to pick up, and from 820.7 million in the year 2011-12, it has now risen to 1.44 billion in the year 2012-13, and in fact, in the current fiscal year, which Pakistan ends on June 30th, we have figures for July to March, that is the first 9 months of the current fiscal year, the foreign direct investment in Pakistan, the net FDI, increased by 6.1% this year, which is a positive sign that the world is once again paying the right kind of attention to and we also, of course, are aware that an extended fiscal fund of US$6.64 billion was negotiated successfully with the IMF in September 2013, which has enabled Pakistan to stabilize its balance of payments and to pay off installments of old debts. And we have also, of course, given the fact that the energy sector is our highest priority, we have paid deep attention to it. And one of the fundamental actions that we took upon assuming office was the payment of nearly $5 billion, 480 million rupees of circular debt that had piled up, and we were able to pay it off in a very short span in the first few weeks in government, which has freed our financial system, which had become clogged by overexposure to the energy sector, and also that has allowed us to add 1,700 megawatts to our energy sector, which of course is also paying dividends in increased manufacturing that we have seen in this fiscal year. And remaining on the energy, the work is in progress on several large energy projects, such as the Dasu Hydro Power Project, the Nandipur Project, the Jamshur Coal Power Project was recently initiated, the Kasa 1000 project, which plans to bring electricity from Tajikistan across Afghanistan into Pakistan. It's a very ambitious regional connectivity project, as well as we're doing a project in the north of the country called Neelam Jhelum, which too will add tidal power to our energy supplies. Pakistan's GDP grew by 5% during the first quarter of the current fiscal year, compared to 2.9% in the previous first quarter, the previous fiscal year, and we are hoping for a GDP growth target of over 4% in the year that will end on the 30th of June 2014. Within the next 3 years, the government plans to raise GDP growth rate to 6 to 7%. More importantly, we intend to raise the investment to GDP ratio to 20%, bring down fiscal deficit to 4% of the GDP, and reduce public debt to below 60% of the GDP as per statutory requirements. And the underlying fundamentals of Pakistan's economy have begun strengthening. And with a robust middle-class consumer base, the recent rise in rural incomes, and one of the world's highest telecom and media penetration, Pakistan is now well positioned for an economic takeoff. And despite our recent struggles, Pakistan remains the 25th largest economy in the world, and it boasts the world's 7th largest labor force. Pakistan has come through, ladies and gentlemen, in the recent decade, a very profound and widespread extremist challenge. We have come through the global financial crisis. We have come through devastating floods in 2010 and again in 2011. We have come through the crippling energy shortages, and we have come through the negative effects of the Afghan war. And this does say something about the resilience of the Pakistani people in general, but also the resilience of Pakistani entrepreneurs and businessmen who have continued to operate. And of course, the USPPC and its members are a part of this resilience story. They have stood by Pakistan, they have persisted in their commitment, and we are certain that their commitment will pay off in a much greater magnitude in the years to come. And factors that support foreign direct investment and FPI, as I said, include the resilience of Pakistan's economy. Pakistan has never defaulted on its own payments, and it has never stopped paying dividends. Pakistan has also signed agreements on avoidance of double taxation in 52 countries, and this coupled with low corporate tax rates and a cost of doing business that compares favorably to its peers in the region, and the ease of doing business, which compares even more favorably with our regional competitors, makes Pakistan an attractive destination for investment. And the confidence of Pakistani diaspora in the economic policies of the new government is manifesting itself in the rise of foreign remittances that come from outside Pakistan into Pakistan. More importantly, the government has embarked upon a program of structural reforms for market development, efficient public sector management. We will ensure fair competition, remove exorbitant taxes, rationalize tariff, remove policy distortions, ease entry barriers, reduce government involvement, and improve regulatory quality. This is an ambitious mandate, ladies and gentlemen, but we believe that now that the direction is right, and with persistence, hard work, and of course follow-up, we will be able to achieve these goals. Most importantly, we will ensure good governance as our core concern, which so far has eluded, very candidly, most Pakistani governments. But it is a profound aim of this government that, yes, we may not be able to go the whole way, but we will definitely put Pakistan on the path of good governance in these 5 years that the people of Pakistan have elected us for. We have also now introduced some months ago a new program of tax incentives, owing to which revenues have increased 17% over the same period last year. The austerity measures undertaken by the government have brought about a 40% cut in expenditures in the Prime Minister's office and 30% cut in all ministries, divisions, and foreign missions. And of course, I was fortunate that I met U.S. Pakistan Business Council in a hotel, so I was able to offer them something with the tea, because of austerity, had they come into my office, they would have just gotten tea. So that's the just a small illustration of the austerity that we face in the office. We're lucky enough that we have sugar to the tea, so the Prime Minister is very keen on it. And we have, in fact, again, in rupee terms, it's not a very large amount. But the 30% cut that we have implemented in our very first year of office demonstrates the seriousness of this point. That before burdening the people of Pakistan, we will cut our expenditure. And that we have been able to institute it, implement it, and it shows again the focus and seriousness of this government towards economic discipline and fiscal discipline. We are also working to restore confidence of investors and businessmen, both local and foreign, through our government's pro-business and transparent policies. And the best reflected in the latest survey, well, not so latest, but still it shows improvement by the Overseas Investors Chamber in Pakistan, which makes for very interesting reading. In August 2012, the Overseas Investors Chamber registered confidence level at -34%. This came into the positive category and was 2% in August 2013, and now we are hoping in the months since August last year that it would have risen considerably. There is a keen interest by investors of several major international companies towards investing in Pakistan, particularly in the energy sector, in which the government has had considerable success in attracting foreign investment, particularly in the new coal-powered plants that we advertised. We have now all been subscribed. In our new alternative energy policy, we are now producing our first 57 megawatts from wind. We hope to have our first 100 megawatts from solar by the end of this year. And this initiative of the government has achieved success, ladies and gentlemen, because of a very clear and transparent energy policy that we have published, in which we are guaranteeing returns in US dollars. So they are guaranteed returns on investment. And this, in of itself, coupled with a slow but sure improvement in governance, has attracted major investment in Pakistan. In the last 11 months, this government has been in office. But apart from the energy sector, there are major sectors in Pakistan identified by the Ministry of Commerce where great opportunities exist, which are infrastructure, housing, agriculture, gems and jewelry, pharmaceuticals. One evidence of the robust strength that we are beginning to see is the performance of the Karachi Stock Exchange. Unbeknown to me, I failed to invest in time and the Karachi Stock Exchange with the, well, it's good for the economy, not good for my portfolio that I didn't invest, because on the 11th of May 2013, ladies and gentlemen, the day of the general election on which the people of Pakistan elected us into government, Karachi Stock Exchange was at 19,916 points. It has since risen 43.74% and now has, on 5th of May 2014, it was at 28,629.60. My loss for the country's gain. So it would be wonderful to look at that. 43.74 rise in the Karachi Stock Exchange. And foreign remittances, as I mentioned earlier, have increased by more than 10%, $9 million in the first 7 months of the current fiscal year. And we really hope that the US-Pakistan Business Council really continue to play its role in bringing businesses in Pakistan and the United States together, because the advantages of the opportunities and participation in the sectors that are highlighted will work for the mutual benefit of both our countries. And Pakistan's exponential growth, as I mentioned earlier, in telecom penetration and technology adoption, and the government's mandate to develop infrastructure allows for the youth-based and fast-growing technology sector to complement US innovation and industry. For the businesses that operate in Pakistan, our country offers liberal and transparent investment policies in different sectors and opportunities for the business communities of both countries. But here, of course, I'll be happy to hear any hurdles which I've committed to remove, of course, as Minister for Hurdle Removal that US businesses operating in Pakistan have been facing. One of the things that I, well, the first thing that I said to US Trade Representative Ambassador Froman yesterday was that the basis of our conversation should be candid and openness. Because only then we can make progress. If you don't speak candidly to each other and continue to sort of dodge the dodgy issues, we can't go forward. So I'm hoping that if there are any issues, I will light it away. And whatever is in our remit, we'll be happy to remove those items. But of course, a number of many US corporations sitting to the left and right are, of course, also around the table, have been in Pakistan for a long time. And they have been able to achieve an extremely positive return on their investments. And of course, this has understandably encouraged some of these companies to expand their investments in Pakistan. We welcome this and strongly feel that US programs can play a key role in disseminating their good stories and business experience in Pakistan to other potential investors in the United States. Wall Street has expressed great interest and enthusiasm in looking at Pakistan as an emerging market during a meeting with Prime Minister Sharif in October last year. But ladies and gentlemen, your motivation and your active interest in contributing to Pakistan's economic growth is highly appreciated. and Government of Pakistan, particularly the Government led by Prime Minister Nawaz Sharif, is committed to providing all possible assistance towards resolution of any issue that may require our assistance. And of course, I want to report to you also the conclusion of our DFAR Council meeting that we held yesterday. It was an interesting fact, which didn't make it into our joint statement, is that DFAR has been in existence for now a decade. But in the 10 years DFAR has been in existence, yesterday was the first time that both countries agreed on an action plan. And the important fact to note is that the plan didn't take 10 years. When there was a will, it took less than 10 weeks. So there is now a will on both the US side and the Pakistani side. As I said earlier, because of the visit of Prime Minister Sharif and his meeting with President Obama in October last year, that we have been able to now move forward. This DFAR Council meeting was explicitly mentioned in the joint statement of Prime Minister Sharif and President Obama. And that's why it was held. And we identified 8 areas in which we will focus as part of our trade dialogue. The first of which is diversifying agricultural production and cooperation, enhancing intellectual property protection. We have also agreed to cooperate with each other in implementing the World Trade Organization's Trade Facilitation Agreement that was agreed in Bali in December last year. Fourth point of the joint plan is engaging each other on Pakistan's accession to the WTO Government Procurement Agreement, GPA, which will allow us eventually, if we are able to accede to that, that we can then move and become eligible for US government procurement contracts. We also focused on increasing trade and services, particularly IT services. For the first time, we also agreed to both governments, particularly it was an offer by the US government that they will cooperate with Pakistan in Pakistan's outreach to state and local governments in the United States. Another, the seventh part was promoting entrepreneurship in Pakistan, and eighth was increasing dialogue between our respective private sectors, which I'm delighted to report we have started working already through today's luncheon meeting, as well as the dialogue that we had this morning at US Trade Representative's office. And from here, right to the next part of that dialogue at the US Trade Office. We also agreed, and it's been an issue, that both governments discussed the market access opportunities for Pakistan to the United States, and given the fact that the GSP program in the US awaits reauthorization. And once it's reauthorized, there would be a formal legal mechanism in which market access would be discussed. But we discussed these issues and exchanged very candid views on how to enhance market access. We also have signed a memorandum of understanding on joint efforts to empower women and promote women entrepreneurship. And I shared in that meeting with Ambassador Froman, and I shared with you that market access, MOU and women come together very interestingly in a fact that in Pakistan's textile sector, the higher up the value chain you go, more women are involved. And at the highest level of the value chain, and now as the Pakistan's textile industry comes to it's almost exclusively who are working in those countries. And employment of those women in those countries has changed the socio-economic contours of a large number of villages in Pakistan. It's just because women have now the opportunity to be economically valuable, contribute to their communities. It's a change the socioeconomic makeup of those villages. So market access development isn't a term that we in the commerce and trade people like to brand it up. There are real human gains made, have been made, and there are very large gains that can be made. And this is what I'm going to talk about. And of course, also, we thanked the USTR office for hosting two business opportunities conferences, first in London in 2012, and then in Dubai last year. But this year we agreed that we should try our best to have the next US-Pakistan business opportunities conference in Pakistan by the end of this year. And we hope to see all of you there, inshallah. And we also agreed to hold the next IFA Council meeting in Pakistan next year. This was the list what we agreed on. But of course, this relationship between Pakistan and the United States is also a very long one, spans decades. We, through our seriousness and focus on economic reform and liberalization, hope to take this relationship to a new level. And to repeat the metaphor I used, we have turned a new leaf. And through your cooperation, we hope to see flowers bloom. Thank you very much.